sure the judge and everyone else here would agree, is respect each other's opinions. You may not agree with everybody, you may not agree about every particular element or issue involved in front of you, but respect each other, respect each other's opinion, listen to each other. That's what you're here for. And most importantly, determine what happened. That's the requirement. You can't have a verdict unless you figured out what makes sense. As Ms. Winkler kept telling you, what is reasonable? What are the elements? What are the evidence? Did they prove their case and come to a conclusion? So let's talk a second about presumptions. There are no presumptions under the law except for one. You don't get to presume anything, nothing, except the presumption of innocence. That's the only thing that you walk in there with. Everything else has to be proved. You don't get to make a jump or a leap in conclusions. Just because you have A and B doesn't mean you get to C. They've got to take you all the way through. They've got to prove each and every element of the offense. If they don't do that, they haven't done their job. You don't get to jump. Even sitting here, after hearing all this evidence, after hearing argument, you have to go back with that presumption. You have to have that in your mind as you look at the evidence. The burden of proof never shifts. It's always here. It's never over there. This is a circumstantial evidence case. Okay? That we've been telling you that from the very beginning. It hasn't changed. All of this evidence is circumstantial. Each of you must decide for yourself what reasonable doubt is. I will propose this to you, and you can take it or leave it as you choose. But a reasonable doubt is anything that causes you to hesitate in the most important of your own affairs. Something that if you're looking at the evidence and you go, wait a second, that doesn't make sense. And then you ask yourself, why doesn't it make sense? Well, this is why. That's a reasonable doubt. Starting with that, look at the evidence. Let's talk about Officer Rodriguez, UTPD. He's following up on a missing persons report. He went into the Waller Creek area. It's a natural area. It's wild. It's overgrown. There's very little light in the evening. It's down below ground level, and there are large buildings on either side. So it gets dark down there fast, and it's rough and rocky ground. And there's water in there. The campus is an open traffic area. Okay, people can walk in and out through campus. We talked a little bit about the homeless population in there. They can wander through campus. There's no stopping entrance into the area. And he found the body. And he told you it was very hard to find, okay? Now, you have to think about Waller Creek. You have to think about this area. And you have a lot of evidence that lets you look at the area. We'll talk about that in a second. That survey mapping equipment, the FARO, okay, it takes forever to load. It's very bulky and awkward to maneuver through. But I encourage you to do that because there are night shots in that. 2 days after the crime, that device puts you in the creek at the same time. So you can see how dark it is down there. Now, when you're looking at it, you'll see bright splashes of light and then darkness. Bright splashes of light are obviously flashlights. Okay? There's been no evidence of a flashlight. So look at the darkness. You can spiral 360 degrees with that thing. Do it. Look at where the lights are. You can see the lights up on the walkway. And most importantly, you can see the cover, the vegetation blocking those lights. It was really dark down there. And that's really, really important. It gives you distances. That's helpful. But essentially, you need to know how far it is from the path to the rocks and how far it is from the rocks to where the hammer, the eyeglasses, and the bra were found. All right. Detective Tynes. We saw Detective Tynes a lot in this case. He was very important. He collected all the evidence. He worked every scene. He's a critical member of the investigation, and it's very important information that he brought to us. He described the creek area. He told us about the natural area, confirming what Rodriguez told you. It's rough ground, it's dark, and that, importantly, there's really only one easy access spot into that creek bed. He told you about the nature of crime scenes, what he does as an investigator, what he looks for, what he's trying to determine. And he talked about natural crime scenes, what happens when nature affects the evidence. And he told us the crime scene speaks to you. And that's important, because this is how you figure out what happened. So let's walk through the crime scene. So here we are at the top of the staircase going down to the walkway into the Waller Creek area. This is the pedestrian bridge here. This is the CLA building back here in the back. You have to come down these steps to get to this part of the path. Once you enter this part of the path, you walk around the landscaping down to where the stone wall is. And here's where the stone wall turns towards into Waller Creek. You gotta walk down this path, and then you gotta make this turn. Now look over here. Over here to the right, you can see the beginning of the drop-off. All the way down through here, there's a drop-off, but not through here. Once you get to the curve, going down the walkway to the back of the Alumni Center, this is the easiest access point into the creek. Why is that important? Because the killer would want to go this way. It's much easier than jumping off the side. Yes, you can jump off the side, but think about that for a second. How hard would that be, either forcing Haruka off the ledge or carrying her body off the ledge? No, this is where you're gonna go. Why is that important to your determination? Because from here to there is a long way. This is not close. You can't even see the rocks where the body is found from here. You have to go all the way down the pathway before you do. You gotta walk down past the wall, all the way to the curve, before you can see the rocks. This is 35 or 40 yards. Check the fire out, check the distances. Please, make sure. Look at the drop-off here. This is the closest point to the rocks, but you wouldn't walk this way carrying a body or forcing someone to travel this way, because they're gonna fall, they're gonna take you down with them when they fall. You wouldn't choose this path. You would go back and choose this one. And this is what the ground is like right through here. Look at the rocks. Think about that for a second. And the testimony that you've heard from both sides on this, you're talking fist-sized rocks that you're walking on top of. At night, in the dark. And if we're talking about this guy over here, someone who is new to Austin. How long have you lived in Austin? How many of you been down in there? Think about that for a second. You have to have already been here and been in here to know the environment, to know the conditions, to know how difficult it would be to maneuver through this area. These rocks are gonna make you fall. They're good, it's difficult terrain. So what did Detective Tynes also tell us? He told us about the blood trail. I'm sorry, the apparent blood trail. Why is it only an apparent blood trail? Because they didn't test it. They told us about the blood on the boulder, boulder number 11. He told us there was no blood. No one presented any evidence of blood on boulder 12. OK? Okay? Those two big boulders there. And the body was found behind boulder 12. The victim's blood was not found anywhere else in this area. The blood trail and on the rock. That's it. Why is this important? So that entryway, the easiest access point down into this area, is behind the photographer at this point. It's back here. You got to walk down that broken part of the east embankment, and then walk south. And then here you see that blood trail. We didn't find any blood over here. It wasn't until here that we find this apparent blood. Now, why is that important? Because this blood is a consistent line to where the body was found over here, but also to where the blood was found here at tent number 9, and then up here on the rock on tent on rock 11. So we talked to Detective Tynes about what this tells us. And he agreed that it was consistent with Hatterkill bleeding, blood dropping here, and then being taken up to here. Look at the pharaoh. Look at how dark it is. You can't see the rock except through the flashlight. Look at the pharaoh. Whoever did this knew this was here. Knew these rocks were here. He led her right to where he wanted her. Because he knew it was there. Here's boulder 11. Here's boulder 12. Look at the distance between the two. Her 5 foot tall, long body is hidden completely behind this boulder. This boulder is longer than 5 feet. The distance between these two, again, check me, please. Look at the pharaoh. It'll tell you the distances. Measure the distance. The distance between these points is over 10 feet. Why is that important? Because we have an extremely large amount of blood on boulder 11. There it is when it's been sprayed with LCB, so you can see the pattern. And here is where the body was found, between these two boulders, under these sticks. This is a very small space. Detective Nelson told you it was less than 2 feet. Detective Tynes told you it was a very cramped, confined area. This is a small space. So what does it tell us? What does this information tell us? She was attacked on the path. If you look carefully from the CLA video, you can actually see the suspect running down. You can see his shadow along the wall running down, all the way down to where the path turns. You can see that in the upper right-hand corner if you look at it close enough. It's there. She was rendered unable to resist almost immediately. We don't know how. But we know she was bleeding by the time she got to that tent marker 5, at least. Most likely she was hit and either rendered unconscious or forced to submit at that point. Ms. Weiser was a very fit young lady. She was strong. She would certainly have not gone willingly. She would have fought had she been able to. I believe that she was rendered either unconscious or stunned at this point, and that she was dragged from there, either carried or dragged, down into the creek and into the location of her death. And I think that's why you see the blood on the ground where you see it. She was most likely carried past that point. We know that also because the blood's not smeared on the ground. and she was placed face down on the rock. Tent 5, that first blood spot, it's smaller than all the rest of them. And it's not smeared. Tent 6, just slightly larger. Again, not smeared. Tent 7, even larger amount of blood. You can tell the rock has little cavities here, and then it's pooling inside these little cavities. Again, not smeared. Tent 9, right below, just to the east of Boulder 11, even larger amounts of blood. Again, not smeared. Because the suspect wasn't dragging her. He was carrying her. She doesn't have any blood on her clothes. I guarantee you, if there was blood on her clothes, you would have heard it. We would have spent a quarter of a day doing just that. So that tells us her clothes were removed prior to the major injuries to her head. Because head wounds are very vascular. Dr. Crowns told us. Head wounds bleed a lot. No blood on her clothes. She's face down on that boulder. How do we know that? Location of the injuries. Here. Here. The injuries to her head are consistent with a jagged instrument causing those injuries. They're not cuts. They're very clear about that. So when she said maybe it was a blade, you know that's not true. Because if it was a blade, it'd be a cut. And we would have heard testimony about that. Dr. Crowns would have told us that. It was jagged. It was the rock. And I asked him, is it consistent with the rock? And he said yes. The fracture on the left side of her head lines up with that jagged cut, that jagged tear to her temple area. Asked him that too. Again, consistent with a rock. And then the ligature. Described it as self-tightening. Once it was tightened, unless someone pulled it off, was going to kill it. And that's the thing. She would have pulled that off if she could have. I mean, that just makes sense, right? I mean, that's perfectly reasonable. I mean, I'm constantly pulling at my collar because it's too tight. Guaranteed, if she could have pulled that away, she would have. But she couldn't because of her other injuries. So we know the head wounds came before that. Now, the doctor talked about bruising, and we'll get to that in a minute. The other thing you need to be aware of is that suspect carried her from Boulder 11, where she died, behind Boulder 12, and dropped her in. He had to carry her around that boulder to place her. It was too tight to get in the other way. And her head was facing south. A lot easier to carry a body head up than head down. He placed her between the boulder and the wall, that small space. He carried her from here to there. Look at the ground cover. This is State's Exhibit 47. This is all moss and algae from this water course coming through. Moss and algae all underneath the boulder, and even where she was killed here under Boulder 11, all the water coming down and through. This is a treacherous area if you're not aware of it. This is an area very easy to slip. Look at the angle of the slope. Look at the slope. Very easy to slip and fall. And here's your distance. He's not carrying across one boulder. He's carrying across two and then around and behind. And into this small space here. Across all this. Again.
How does he know it's there?
How does he know in the pitch dark that this is there? You can't see it because this lip face is higher than this. When you're on this side, on the downslope side, looking across, you can't see it. You have to know it's there to take her there. Detective Tynes also told there was a lot of debris in that area. I think he said there was a mattress. There were multiple items that were not collected or tested. And there were other items that were collected and not tested. There was a bunch of clothing articles found in the ravine. And this is important because this is where they want you to start leaping to conclusions, taking that extra step. They have to prove the distance, remember that. They got to prove each step of the way. There was underwear found near the body. 10:13. It was never presented to you. It's not in any of these bags. You won't find that underwear here. There was a shirt on the ground in the middle of the stream area. Again, it's not in these bags. There were socks on the east embankment. Not here. There's a shirt on the east embankment. Again, not here. This is the boulder next to boulder 11. There's that first pair of underwear right there. Closest article of clothing that is not directly related to her, to the body. There's the shirt. Now, their theory is the suspect killed her, covered her up, and then started walking south down the ravine. And then crossed over to the east embankment underneath the Alumni Center, or next to the Alumni Center, but there's an overhang right behind it. Because where he raped and brutally murdered the girl wasn't private enough? I mean, isn't that the whole idea? If you're trying to hide from someone, you're going to commit the crime in a place you feel safe enough to commit the crime? But he decides to go over here for a little extra privacy after he's hidden the body? Does that make sense? Of course it makes sense if you leap to the conclusion that the bra is first. Because then it's tied to the body, right? So obviously he did because there's a bloody bra there, right? There's the shirt. This is the path across. You can see the tents over here. This is State's Exhibit 90. You can see the tents where they found the other items that they believe are all part of the offense. So again, the person crossed across the creek in the dark, not able to see, on these little rocks, like Detective Tynes told us, and set up camp over here, and this is where he left stuff. So on that east embankment, we find the hammer, we find the bra, we find the socks, we find the glasses, we find the glove. All right here. Hammer, glove, or hammer, bra, socks, glasses over here. Now, didn't collect the glove, didn't think it was important, but it's right in the same area. So we won't know. So why is the bra important? Well, we had Ms. Fagali come up here, Ruka Weiser's roommate. She said she didn't recognize the blue duffel, but they did have another friend of the victim that did. She told us the victim wore glasses, those were never found. And she did not identify the bra. Think back to the testimony. There was not one witness that got up here and told you that is her bra. Not one. Didn't identify the blood on it. Didn't identify the make and model of the bra. Didn't bring anyone that said, oh yeah, that looks like something she was wearing. And it's different from all of her other bras. At least the ones that we can see. Here's the bra, down at the seam. And they showed it to you. Here is State's Exhibit number 17. Her underwear drawer. We see athletic bras here and here, and we see padded bras in a very neat and orderly fashion here. This doesn't match any of those. And if you look, they're, well, as far as I can, and I'm no expert on bras, but there are two kinds of bras in this thing. And neither of them are those. So why is that important? Because if it's her bra, the hammer's important. The glasses are important. If it's her bra. If it's not her bra, they're 35 yards south of the body. There's no usable DNA found at the scene. There were no fingerprints found at the scene. There was no suspect hair found at the scene. There's no proof the bra is the victim's. There's no evidence that she was assaulted with a hammer. Remember what Dr. Crowns told us. The injuries on her head are all consistent with the rock. There's no blood found on Mikael's clothing. No blood. How do you carry someone with that amount of trauma to her head and not get blood somewhere on your body? That's pretty impressive. That's really impressive. Now, they want you to believe he's wearing the green shirt at the time he kills her. And he's wearing those blue jeans because those are the only jeans he has. Not a spot of blood on either. The items on the east embankment were found south of the body. South. The bike, which we know the suspect went back and got, is north of the body. Why does he walk further away from his mode of transportation? Why doesn't he walk back north up the ravine? There are plenty of places up there. You can stand underneath the bridge. You see pictures of the bridge, how big it is and how much area that is underneath. It's a perfect area to stand under if you were going to take a moment to collect yourself. But no, they want you to believe he went south. Because why? They can tie it to somebody if he walks south. Or at least they think they can. Extremely dark, rough terrain, crossing the creek in the dark. All these things are telling you someone who knows the ravine, knows what's there, has been there before, can get around in there. Crossing from open areas that are dark to even darker areas that are enclosed. All right, let's talk about that storage room now. We know the UT personnel entered on March 30th. We know Mikael was polite and cooperative. Asked him to leave, okay, I'll leave. He packed up and he left. It took him a while, but he packed up and left. And he left things behind. Some of those things on purpose, because he didn't have room to carry it, and some of those things on accident. That's what he told us. Surveillance. This really is where everything started. And everything begins to fall apart. Begier? Beeger? Not really sure how to say that. McCrozick spent 650 hours each on this. That was really important. How many times did they say that? What do you think? At least four. Why? Why would they tell us that four times? They think you forgot the first three? No, because it's important for you to understand how much effort these two men went through. 1,300 hours looking at video, straining their eyes, looking at the big screen. That's all they did for weeks, looking at video, so that they could come in here and tell you they know where the suspect was, they backtracked him for you, you don't have to look. Open those discs. There are a ton of files in there. I was actually really happy that Ms. Winkler put up that list of locations and times to make it easier for you to see. Please look at them. Please. Why? You tell me if you can identify anybody from that. Some of those shots, you can't even tell it's a person. They wanted you to believe that they tracked the suspect from beginning to end. Hundreds and hundreds of hours is what the state just told you a minute ago. Again, emphasizing that so that you will understand that they're right because they spent so much time. You don't have to. It's okay. You don't have to. They tracked this person by cues, by the things he was wearing. That's the basis of their analysis. He told you that from the stand. He was tracking by what he's wearing and what he's riding. And they backtrack into 8:42 p.m. 8:42. Remember those numbers, because this is where it all goes down. This is where the state's case implodes. They followed him once he reappeared all the way to 11:28. He's on camera, except for that 45 minutes, continuously. That's what they're telling you, continuously, except for those 45 minutes. From 8:42 to 11:28. You get close-ups three different times from CLA camera and from the ATM camera. And what did he tell you on cross? Berger? He could not identify the person based upon his 650 hours of analysis. He never said, I saw this defendant. What did they tell you on their open? What did she say? Mr. Berger saw the defendant. Why? Skip that part. It's a lot simpler. They watched him a couple of hundred times. And he described to us the cues that he identified, the things that he was looking for, the things that stood out to him, the things that were important enough to him that he spent 650 hours tracking. Let's talk about the glasses. What did he tell us? They're not aviator glasses. Okay, that's kind of general. That's one type of glass. That's leaving yours. Leaves all those open. Slightly smaller. Larger sides. And possibly a shiny stripe on the sides. This is all straight out of testimony. If you have a dispute, ask for it. That's why you write all these things down. Shiny temples with shiny rims. Okay. Austin Fire responds. On that Monday morning to a light box. They go and describe it as a warming fire. Small fire, trying to keep warm. They're just trying to help. Everybody agrees on that. Came in there, they found a young man, a boy, and they were trying to help him. So what did Mr. Wormsman tell us? He told us his daughter's about to go to UT. He told us he was hyper aware. It's a quote. That's his words, hyper aware of the investigation. Because he's got a daughter about to go to UT. So of course he's paying attention to it. Everybody was paying attention to it. When he saw the video, he had an immediate reaction to the video. But what was the first thing he told us that he, on cross-examination, that he identified? Right here. He had a physical reaction from his head to his toes. What is a physical reaction? An emotional reaction. He had an emotional response because he felt betrayed. He helped a boy. He went out of his way. He didn't have to do that. It was wonderful that he did. He helped the boy, and he felt betrayed because he saw this bike. And he had an emotional response to that betrayal. The officers that responded, Garcia ran a history, nothing concerned him. He transported Miguel. Gonzalez, the one with the accent, spent more time inside and spent time with Mick. He told us there were two other bikes in the building, three bikes, and there are photographs and evidence of those. He told us nothing stopped Mick from just getting on his bike and riding away. He could have just hopped on this puppy right here, slung on his backpack, rode off into the sunset. Kept making a point of that. Could have just rode off into the sunset. He was free. He could just move. He could just go. He could just ride. That's what a guilty person does. Guilty people flee. They run away because they're afraid, because they know they've done something wrong, because they're scared of being caught. Guilty people run. Innocent people don't flee from the police. What do? If you're in trouble and you're innocent, you ask for help. They offered you help. You take the help. Because you have nothing to hide. You don't know anything about a murder at that point. No one has said a word. He's not connected to the internet. He's got no electronic access in that building. It wasn't even known. The body wasn't even found for another day. He had no idea that this was all going on. Gonzalez was there for 45 minutes. He was getting annoyed. He was impatient. He had to explain it to him many times, and he made a point of emphasizing that. Many times he had to explain to him, you gotta go. And he told us Mick took a long time to pick his stuff. And in the end, what did the fire department do? They just started throwing stuff in the bag and throwing stuff in the trash can. And he had to leave a lot of things behind, just like at the storage room. Officer Gonzalez had threatened him with arrest if he didn't hurry up, because he was just taking too long. Took some time, went over to medical arts, and he found that trash can. And he told us he had to go through it in layers. Just like an archaeologist, you got to go down each piece, one at a time. There are multiple things piled up in that trash can on top of each other. I asked him about transferring contamination. Transfer. What is transfer? You touch something, you leave something behind, or pick something up. Things like moisture, sand, hair. All these things are in this container. stacked up in layers. Once you peel off the first couple top layers, what do you have? This jacket. Why didn't you take this jacket? He had other jackets. Why did he have this one? Why did he take this one? Because he told us. He found it in that trash bag that morning with all the other stuff. That's why everything was there at that location. All of this stuff was together. States 156. You can see the sandy clothing. All of it sitting here at the bottom of the trash can. The victim's turtleneck. Look at it. Look at the condition. Wet and sandy. No one actually identified who this belongs to, but I'm pretty sure that was hers. Wet and sandy. You can see the sand at the bottom of the trash can. You can see the moisture on the wall of the trash can. It's all right there. Sandy boxers. Now, this is interesting to me for a couple of reasons. Because these boxers, we don't know whose they are. Right? Did you recall the testimony? Did anyone come up here and said, those have his DNA on them? No. Did anyone come up here and say, those have somebody else's DNA on them? No. But they're wet and sandy, so they must belong to the killer. States 208, sandy boxers. Look at the pattern. Defense Exhibit 2. Just a random picture of Haruka Weiser's dorm room. Look in the corner on the bed. What does that look like? Plaid boxers. Guess everybody has a pair. Right there. I don't know whose they were. They don't know whose they were. You don't know whose they were. You have no evidence to base any analysis on that. It's in a pile at the bottom of the trash can. What did Tyreek tell us? He was with Haruka when they left to see dance hall. And he was with her all afternoon. They left together at around 9:30. She was wearing all black. She was wearing her glasses. She was carrying her blue duffel bag. Glasses that no one ever found. They're not anywhere. I guarantee you, if they had her glasses, they'd be in evidence. They're not. So let's talk about the glasses we do have, and again, that assumption they want you to make. Bertha Burnett told us she bought two pairs of glasses from the guy. He wore his glasses with no complaints. Wore his glasses with no complaints. She could not find the original broken pair in Killeen after he left. And he left with no warning. He left with his black backpack and what he had going to school that day. That's important later. Noelia Warren, IMART Express. I start to really wonder about my glasses and the accuracy and, I don't know, safety in wearing them now. So she measured the glasses and she told us they're close enough. Okay, so probably not the best bedside manner for, you know, instilling confidence in IMART Express. But they're close enough. Multiple checks to verify, because customer service is important as long as we're close enough. She checked the glasses. She verified the glasses. that they were correct, that they were written as according to the prescription, and she issued the glasses. So, the glasses are really interesting on a couple grounds. Everybody told you tolerances are close enough. They're close enough. It's got to be him. It's got to be his glasses because the tolerances are close enough. Client doesn't complain, we don't fix it. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. So clearly, she's saying that the 17-year-old boy put on the glasses and didn't bother to complain, even though they weren't right. That's what this is asking you to believe. They make sure they fit. They make sure they can see. They go through the process. Even though the pupillary distance is way, way off. Now, she showed you, where was the ruler? Love that. She showed the millimeters, right? 51 millimeters versus 63. On cross, they admitted it wasn't an exact match because the pupillary distance was not correct. And it's an important number. It's an important number. Slide your glasses over a centimeter and see how you see. They keep telling you it's unique. This is a unique pair of glasses. This is an incredibly rare pair of prescriptions because unique means identifiable in the criminal world. Identifiable means you can link it to someone and get a conviction. They kept telling you six different parts. It's right here. Six different parts. It's unique. It's exact. It's an exact measurement. Okay. Except for the pupillary distance. And that's not important, really. It's just, you know, it's just your eyes. That's not important. You don't need to see. But she told us that these glasses that she issued had this serial number on them. And she backed that up by saying that all that's left on this on the glasses is this BKC. And you can see it on the glasses. That this serial number right there on the screen in front of you is on the glasses. So you get to take this back with you. Here are the glasses. Right? Exact match. Has a serial number on it. Left arm. Look at the glasses. You see the BKC, you also see a partial number next to it, just to the left. That partial number is not a 5. It's either an 8 or a 0. Don't believe me. Please, don't believe me. Look at the glasses. An exact match. What did Deepin tell us? He did the examination. He wrote the prescription. He looked at the glasses, and they were close enough. Again, close enough. He's not required to take the pupillary distance. Why does he tell us that? Because he can get sued. He's a doctor. So he was very quick to say, oh, well, no, on cross. No, I'm not required to do that. No one asked him that, but he's not required, and that's fine. But his prescription for the pupillary distance was 63. And he told us 5 millimeters is too much. He would not have allowed someone out of his office with a 5 millimeter difference. Less than half what those are to him. Less than half. because it causes headaches, blurry vision, double vision. It's dangerous for someone to walk around with incorrectly fit glasses. 1.2 centimeters. Looks really small, but apparently it's a big deal. Because why? Dr. Deepin told us so. And he told us he would not drive a car with a 5 millimeter differentiation in the pupillary distance. So these are not his glasses. What did Dr. Crowns tell us? Cause of death, strangulation with blunt force trauma. The victim was 5 feet tall, 125 pounds. There were no signs of scratches on the neck around the ligature. And the only sign of restraint was the bruising to the inside of the elbows. And I asked him about where the bruising would be. Would it be someone holding you from the front or someone holding you from the behind? He said he couldn't really say. But it looked like it would be someone using two hands to restrain the victim's arms to cause such a symmetry in the bruising on the inside of the arms. Well, if he's holding her with two hands, how is he taking off her clothes or beating her or doing any of the other things he would have had to have done? That restraint would have had to be minimal, or at least for a minimal amount of time, because all these other things had to have happened. And he also told us 125 pounds. Now, I asked him, which would you rather pick up? 125 pounds that was stiff, or 125 pounds, and I think he used the word bag of jello. And he told us, stiff, because it's easier. If you've ever picked up a bag, a heavy bag, that has no physical structure inside of it, it's just a bag, it's a lot harder to pick up and move, because it is dead weight. It resists easy transport. Okay. Let's get to the reasonable doubt part. Extraction on the tablet computer. Now, I want you to think that there was shaking and jostling going on, that this computer over here in evidence is going to turn itself on because it's in his backpack and he's bouncing around an old trusty over here. But I asked Mr. Fuentes to separate the tablet. And we went through all that for this exact purpose. You can take that back in evidence. You take it back in evidence, you can take it apart. Go right ahead. I asked him, how hard was it to separate it? And he said it required some force. It required some force just to open it, because that is a stiff hinge. If it's closed, it's locked together. If it's locked together, the two pieces aren't coming apart. If it's not coming apart, then how do we have a USB interaction? That computer was being used. Used. A human being was interacting with that machine at the time this happened. It was booting up, it had errors, and it rebooted. He had to turn it off and turn it back on. There's no other way that works. Now, they want you to believe that he just left it on sitting there in his room. Now, you and I might do that, right? Because we plugged it into the wall, right? You leave your computers plugged in, you leave them on, my computer's on right now. Because it's plugged in to an electrical outlet that is attached to our wonderful City of Austin power grid. That building had no heat, no water, and most importantly, no electricity. So how is this computer just sitting there rebooting? It would die. He told us. He went back to the hospital every day, get coffee, get water, to work on the internet, get stuff off the internet, and to charge his devices. He's not going to leave it open. And even if he is leaving it open, how is it restarting? It's all there. In the testimony of Manny Fuentes, in the cross-examination, if you don't believe me, ask for it. Please. This is the job, right here. This is the proof, right here, that that man, that boy over there, did not kill Hatako Weiser. Something was being installed in the USB. From 8:43 through 9:33, all of this was going on. All of this part right here. At the same time, the suspect is riding a bicycle through UT campus. Remember, 8:42 is when they first picked him up on the videos. Hundreds and hundreds of hours spent making sure so that you could believe the suspect is on video at 8:42 p.m. on April 3rd, 2016. 1 minute before, Mikhail Kreiner turns his computer on 2 miles away. Defense exhibit number, I think it's number 9. April 3rd, 2016, 9:17 p.m. Someone installed, connected something into the USB drive. This is not circumstantial evidence. This is direct evidence of human interaction with the laptop. Now, the circumstantial evidence that I would propose is that it was that boy over there that was doing it. But no one else was in the building, no one else had their computer, just him. So this is him at 9:17 p.m. installing something into the computer. Now, I don't know how much computing you do while biking, but I'm going to imagine it's pretty hard to ride a bike, especially one as wonderful as this, while installing some device into a USB drive. I'm going to imagine that this is reasonable doubt, because, in fact, it is. So what did Mick tell us? He told us about his history. He told us where he came from. He told about growing up a little bit. He didn't get into all the details, but he told you a little bit about where he's from. Four removals from four different homes. He told you he disliked CPS. He wanted to get out of there as fast as he could. I mean, he told you he thought Eartha was wonderful. It was a wonderful home. She was very supportive. She was very helpful. She was a great witness. She was a great foster mom. But even so, he just one day walked out. He walked to Houston from Texarkana. As a 16-year-old kid, that's pretty amazing. That's not a short trip. It took 5 days, he told us. He walked to Austin. Didn't make it very far, but he did. He told us he was living on the streets, hand to mouth, trying to survive, eating 3-day-old yogurt. He's trying to find food. Trying to find shelter. He was trying to find safety. And he kept scouting around, looking for better places, better opportunities, trying to survive. Place to place to place. Begging for food, begging for money, living hand to mouth. He chose this. He chose this existence. Why? Because he's not very smart. he doesn't think ahead. Now, I'm not saying he's stupid. I'm absolutely not saying that. But he doesn't think ahead. He doesn't plan. He doesn't consider consequences for his actions. Now, they're going to make a big deal about that in a minute, because that sounds really bad when they say it. But here's the point. He chose this over Eartha, and he had no complaints at Eartha. He told us he wanted to be a writer. So now I got to talk about this. Talk about the story. That was just gross. Why do they read that to you? Why did they read that to you? What was the point? Think about everything we've done up here as lawyers. All of these boxes, all of this stuff. Everything had a point. Everything. Every word out of our mouths, every action that we do, every step that we take, it has a purpose. What was this purpose? How did it make you feel? Story. Did you enjoy it? Did you like it? No. Did it help you decide an issue in this case? Did it prove that Mikhail Kreiner killed Hadakalizer? Did that story help you in some way decide a factual issue in this case? And there's only one factual issue in this case. Did the story identify him as the killer? No. It has no relation to this offense whatsoever, other than it's gross. I guess that's the relation. But what is gross? What is gross mean to you? What does gross do to you? What does that make you feel? Spend a lot of time talking to him about that. Think about the cross-examination. Think of how important that moment was. Pass the witness. Your witness, sir. You've got a guy charged with capital murder sitting in front of you, waiting to be eviscerated. You got a guy charged with capital murder who's childlike. How easy is that? That's a gift. This story was there to do one thing and one thing only: piss you off. Inflame your passions against Mick. That's the point. That's why it's there. That's the only reason. Why? Because desire over evidence is the fastest way you can get to a conviction. If you're mad, you will make mistakes. You will leap over fallacies and holes and jump to conclusions because you're mad. Basic human psychology. Before they found Mick, this is the guy they were following around. We asked him, he came into evidence, he had a history of sexual assaults and bike theft, women's bike theft. That's why they were looking at him. This was the basis of the case that they were building, and they started with him. Because he looks like the suspect. He wears glasses. And he has a history of being on the UT campus. Him. Right there. It's in evidence. 5'10". 175 pounds.
African-American. Short haircut. Glasses.
Cut. Strong. Why does that matter? Because that's that kid over there. Look at his chest. Look at his arms. This is the guy that picked up 125 pounds of dead weight and carried it 10 feet and dropped it into a crack? That arm? No way. No way. I like his odds better. So Mick told you he was dumpster diving. And that he found this stuff over here in this dumpster. We looked at all these other dumpsters just so that you would have an idea of the kind of environment this is. That there's all these locations where you can find stuff that other people have thrown away. We told you he found a couch. He found the couch right here at this dumpster. And he had to get help to bring it this little distance here. And a girl had to help him get it into this building. There's a picture of the front of that building, of this northern-facing door. There's a 2-foot ledge because the step has been removed. So he had to lift it up those 2 feet, and he needed help doing that. So he's young. Clearly he's not a planner. He walked away from a good, decent home where he was well-treated, cared for, helped, provided for, fed. She's going to take him to the park, to a party that night. That was a good woman who did. It was there. It was Eartha Brunette. Was a good woman here trying to help him. But he just got a wild hair and left. He doesn't think ahead. And he was honest. Oh my God, is he honest. And just disturbing to me as an attorney how honest he was. To an incredible fault. Doesn't look so good for me. You're charged with capital murder. You're on the stand. You're testifying in front of 14 people who are going to decide your fate. And you turn to them and say, doesn't look so good for me. How stupid do you have to be to say that? If you're going to lie, that's when you lie. Well, there's no way they're going to convict me. This evidence is terrible. How could you even bring this case? Anything except for that. That is the dumbest thing he could have said. Because God forbid you believe it. Go ahead and believe it. Because he's honest to a fault. And he was honest with you. When he sat up here and he said those things to you. If he was going to lie, he would not have said that. I don't know if anyone saw me. My reaction did when he said that, but I couldn't stop myself from rolling my eyes. I couldn't stop myself from, oh my God, what did he just do? But he said it. Doesn't look good for me. Assumptions. Do not assume evidence. Do not assume A, B, then C. Go through each step. Go through each piece. They're excellent attorneys. They have presented a solid case to you. A bunch of circumstantial evidence that revolves all the way around the front end of the murder and the back end of the murder. They've done a terrific job with what they have. But they don't have the middle piece. They don't have the middle piece. They have stuff before, and they have stuff after. And they want you to fill in the blank. For those of you from Monday, this is the Spider-Man right here.
This is where they fill in the blank and they want you to guess. Don't leap to those conclusions. Think about it. Think about it. Confirmation bias all the way through this case. Everybody left the conclusion it was him because they found him with the stuff. And that's what they want you to do. You swore an oath. You swore an oath to review the evidence, to look at the evidence, and to make a decision based on that evidence. They must meet their burden. They must prove every step of the road to get you to beyond a reasonable doubt. Look at each piece of evidence individually. Is it strong? Is it weak? What does it convince me of? Then look at them together. What do these pieces of evidence tell me? How do they link together to create a chain? Is that chain consistent all the way through from beginning to end? Do I have to skip over a link in the chain to go from here to there? Identify those moments. Think about it. Process it. You're logical, reasonable people. That's why you're here. The presumption of evidence is enough to acquit. The judge read that to you. It's in the charge. Mick did not commit this crime. Look at the evidence, and you'll see all those pieces they want you to look at, all that circumstantial evidence coming together. But at the time of the murder, the computer was being used. Ask for that if you don't believe me. Please. Look at the testimony. Remember the testimony that you heard. There were 50 different operations going on, more than 50 operations going on during this time period. Because the computer was booting, it was failing, and it had to be rebooted. That doesn't happen by itself. Someone has to push the button. That someone was that boy over there. If he's pushing the button, who's killing the girl? He's innocent.